support and mildew and suitable for green and red chili markets. She has developed stable cytoplasmic genic male sterile lines of chili and using them has developed 4 high yielding chili F1 hybrids, Arka Meghana, Arka Harita, Arka Shweta and Arka Khyati, suitable for diverse market segments with tolerance to powdery mildew, CHVMV and CMV for commercial cultivation. The parental lines of all these hybrids have been licensed to about 20 private seed companies. PPV and FRA, New Delhi, has recognized her as nodal officer for development of dust guidelines and dust testing of chili, sweet pepper and paprika. Dr. Madhavi has also contributed to the development of 4 tomato and 4 brinjal varieties, and she has guided 10 PhD and 8 MSc students and published more than 100 research papers in reputed journals. A native of Chittur in Andhra Pradesh, Dr. Madhavi had her early education in Chittur and obtained her graduate and postgraduate degrees in agricultural sciences from SV Agriculture College of APAU Tirupati and was awarded Kasu Brahmananda Reddy Gold Medal for securing highest OGPA in the university. She got her PhD in horticulture from College of Agriculture APAU, Hyderabad, as an ICAR Senior Research Fellow. She has received ICAR awards for multidisciplinary research twice during 2010 and 2016, and is also the recipient of ICAR IIHR Best Teacher Award during 2021. She is a fellow of National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, National Academy of Horticultural Sciences, and Indian Society of Vegetable Science. Dr. Madhavi has organized 4 national and 2 international conferences and workshops, and has also participated in several national and international conferences. We are very glad to have you with us, Madhavi. You have reached the 100 mark. 100 people are participating and eagerly waiting to listen to you. Over to you, Dr. Madhavi.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Good morning, one and all, and my namaskars. I don't know how far I can justify. I try to share my knowledge. For the past 30 years, I'm working with these peppers. May not be having commercial knowledge, but I do have about the crop. I feel I can explain you better, and it may be a sort of, I would like to share my screen now with your permission.
Please do, Dr. Madhavi.
Thank you, sir. Hope it is visible, sir.
Yes, we can see it clearly.
Yeah.
All can see, I understand. Dr. Aparna, everybody can see this?
Yes.
I think so. Yeah.
Yes, sir, we can.
Please go ahead, Dr. Madhavi.
At the outset, first, I have to thank your foundation for inviting me to deliver a talk on this. And of course, Dr. Sharanangadi sir and Dr. Tikku sir have called me and asked me to share my knowledge on chili crop improvement. My talk will be like, I will be introduced the introduction about the crop and origin distribution, about the species and breeding for biotic and abiotic stresses, and of course, nutritive value, quality, and for industrial use, and for mechanization, and for the future perspectives and summary. For any crop improvement, multidisciplinary approach is must. Just developing a variety which is having highly resistant to
disease. Excuse me, ma'am. Can you this sign hide? If you can hide, you can see it clearly down the line.
Yeah.
Bottom of the slides, there is something, yeah, hide it. Right side, there is option of hide, yeah, yes. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Any crop improvement, development of variety will not do. Anyway, for developing any variety, genetic resources is the prime criteria. And then, of course, we have to screen for the whatever trait we are looking for and study the genetics. And then, of course, distinct hybridization is very well required nowadays because to widen our genetic base. Whatever variety we develop, without other divisional help, like pathologists or entomologists, we cannot breed any resistance. And also for definitely agronomy, any variety with best agronomic practices only, it will perform the best. So this is always in a multidisciplinary approach, not only for chili, for any crop. These are all very important branches which we have to depend on. As we all know, the chilies originated from Central and Southern America, and it got distributed across the world. And we received to India around 600 years back on sea route by Columbus. Since then, it's being cultivated in our country. There are so many wild species. In that, 5 species have been domesticated in our country, all are having to a number 24. The 3 recognized species complexes of capsicum, that is the capsicum annuum complex, and that's a capsicum annuum, fruticans, chinans, chepiens, and galapagos, and a bucketum complex, it is preternism and thorari, and pubescens is another complex, where there are 3 species are come under this particular complex. This knowledge is very much required for pre-breeding. Okay, first we have to know about the gene pool concept. When within the crossable species, when we can do, this is the primary gene pool. And whereas the buccatum, this is the primary gene pool for this, and pubescens. And the secondary gene pool through different approaches, either if it is not crossable, it is well and good. Otherwise, through bridge crossing, we can have a tertiary gene pool, secondary gene pool, and the overall entire genome will come under this tertiary gene pool. This gene pool is very precious for any breeder. Because of continuous domestication and breeding, you all know that we lost our genetic diversity, and which we have to improve and enhance this. For this, the maximum genetic diversity, if it is in the cultivated species, what we are using. Otherwise, if we cross between the cultivated and land, this is called pangenome. This concept is becoming very important nowadays. And if we can pull the genes from the wild relatives, that is called super pangenome. This is how we have to broaden our genetic base, which will lead to our crop improvement. This is the cross-compatibility chart, which everybody have to keep in their mind while going for pre-breeding. This will give very good clue for us how to go ahead further. The pangenome in pepper, OU et al. In 2018, he has published that each of the 5 cultivated species has 12 chromosomes, all 5 cultivated species, and the genome of 2 capsicum annuum cultivars were first sequenced in 2014. The CM334 complete genome is available now, and the genomes of buccatum, PBC81, and the chinans, PA159236, were also sequenced and reported very recently by Kim et al. In 2017. According to these studies, the genome size of the peppers vary between 3.2 to 3.9 GB. It is almost equivalent to human genome size it is. Whereas tomato, it's very a smaller genome compared to peppers. Of course, nearly 80% of which consists of repetitive regions.
And the madam, please go back to the slide for compatibility chart. Just I want to take note on here. 1 minute, madam. Yeah, thank you, madam. Please continue, madam.
The phylogenetic analysis of 383 pepper cultivars reported that the chinans and fruticans are very closely related to each other compared to annuum, though they belong to the same, they come under one group. Whereas buccatum, you can see it is far away from this with a longer karyotype lengths. And pepper pangenome browser, this is the high quality genes have been classified into core genes, a total genes of 51,757 genes and species specific genes resulting in 15 groups. Among 4 species of high quality genes form the core genes of the pepper pangenome. This 4,633 genes, 8.9% of that were not in any of the 15 groups in this Venn diagram. This is there are a lot of publications on PAN genome. People who are interested, they can go through. It will be very quite interesting, and it will be very useful for us for the pre-breeding purpose. Once the resources are there, first the germplasm conservation. This is very, very important. The public germplasm repositories distribute plant material for research, education, training, and developmental purposes. Concerns regarding phytosanitary issues, which is very, very important. This will limit or completely prevent germplasm distribution among the international germplasm repositories and to the plant breeders and other scientists internationally. A comprehensive understanding of gene bank coverage and collaboration among the public germplasm repositories can successfully cover the research gaps. And there are two largest collections of capsicum germplasm. One is the World Vegetable Center, Taiwan, and another one is USDA in USA. As on 2018, the World Vegetable Center has 7,853 accessions, whereas USDA has 4,871 accessions. Apart from this, the Tropical Agricultural Research and Higher Education Center germplasm database houses 884 capsicum accessions, and Chili Pepper Institute at New Mexico State University maintains a large collection of both domesticated as well as wild species. National Gene Banks of India, South Korea, China, Netherlands, France, Japan also maintain collections of capsicum germplasm. Actually, India is considered a second center of origin, mainly because of the rich biodiversity what we have, peppers. Though it got introduced to our country more than 500 years back, because as we started liking its flavor, pungency, color, though chili is considered a self-pollinated crop, a large extent of cross-pollination has been reported. With this, and due to the continuous selection of the farmers, we have a lot of land races existing in our country. You all may be knowing in Northeast region, we have very highly pungent types and we have very good color types. Like this, we do have a lot of land races for chili especially. Now with the availability of all this, now we have to search and develop the valuable resources. The thing is, the very important thing for the pepper breeders is male sterility systems. As you all know how important it is. Then the biotic stresses, here mainly the fungal diseases. There are many diseases, but the powdery mildew, we can say it is one of the important diseases. Then followed by Phytophthora root rot. It is becoming very serious. Then anthracnose root rot. This year, all of you might have seen the severity of the anthracnose, the green fruits getting infected. These are the 3 to 4 major fungal diseases where do we have to concentrate. And of course, in bacterial diseases, the Ralstonia, Solanacea, and bacterial wilt as such, Ralstonia will not cause wilt in chili, except in high humid and high temperature regions like coastal regions of Odisha, maybe the other side, and in Kerala, they have reported bacterial wilt is a problem. Otherwise, in the mainland, bacterial wilt as such is not a problem. If bacteria is there inside and if it gets infected with Phytophthora or any other fungal diseases, however you drench, the plant will not recover if bacteria is there inside. So keeping that in view, we may have to look for a line while breeding which is having some tolerance to bacteria also. Then of course viral diseases, they have been causing very big havoc. More than 40 viruses have been reported in capsicums. In that major ones, 4 to 5 viruses we can concentrate. Mainly the AP transmitted viruses, the CMV and CVMV. CMV is a kokoma virus and CVMV is a potivirus. Next important, very important, and recently it is causing a big problem is viperally transmitted Gemini virus, which was not at all a problem earlier. For the past 10 years, we are observing as a very serious. And next is a thrips transmitted TOSPA viruses. Then apart from that, the insect pests, of course, we were thrips and mites, of course, always they are sucking pests, but this year really the thrips have caused a very big havoc. We recently visited Telangana and Andhra Pradesh major chili growing areas, almost a devastated majority of the areas. Probably reasons may be many why the minor pest has become very serious this year, that we'll discuss a little later. Now, of course, nematodes is a problem. It is a universal problem. Among the abiotic stresses, about heat, moisture stress, and salinity, these are the major abiotic stress problems. And quality, of course, we may have to bring for good color, pungency, because a lot of industrial usage is there for this. So we may have to concentrate for color, pungency, of course, as a total oleoresin. And of course, nutrition also. All these days, we were not giving much importance for the nutrition point of view. But now we may have to look into, because chili is also a very rich source of vitamins. Then the mechanization. This is becoming the priority right now because of the labor problem. The harvesting is very tedious in chili. So we may have to look for mechanization that treats how it has to be. Of course, here I have given the estimated yield losses. Of course, it again varies with the stage of infection and also the cultivation practices. So there are people have reported for major diseases, what is the percent of yield loss due to this diseases. First, coming to the male sterility systems, both nuclear male sterility and the CMS system, both have been exploited commercially in peppers. Mainly in chili, both are commercially exploited. Very recently, Jindal et al. 2019, they have reviewed very nicely about the molecular advancements of in male sterility systems of capsicum. You might have seen this paper, but it's very quite interesting and very useful review paper. As you all know, to strengthen the heterosis breeding, mass is important to facilitate parental breeding. Of course, earlier we used to do conventionally, but once the markers are available, it is giving good confidence for us as a breeder, whether I'm going in a right direction or not. So marker-assisted selection is always good for breeder. And both the nuclear and cytoplasmic systems have been utilized for hybrid development in chili. In bell peppers, mostly nuclear male sterility, now people are also looking for CMS system. Here the restoration is becoming a problem. So people are still trying to overcome that. Coming to the nuclear arginic male sterility, the title link markers will facilitate the breeders through mass, and otherwise it is very cumbersome, as you all know. These are the markers which have been already reported. Different genes have been identified, and the location, chromosomal location is also already published, which can be used in our programs. And next comes CMS. It's actually CGMS, but popularly called as CMS system. Here the mitochondrial gene as well as the fertility restorer genes. These are the two things which you have to look into. The mitochondrial gene ATP6, it is very strong candidate gene. It's being used throughout the country and it is working very well. And then fine mapping of the gene would look at markers that overlap or closer to the loci, the locus. This would facilitate rapid screening of germplasm and accelerate the transfer of RF gene, breeding a maintainer line. The maintenance of the maintainer line and the restorer line is very, very important in homozygous condition. For that, really markers will help us. Otherwise, again, we'll be losing one season to confirm whether it is homozygous condition or heterozygous condition. So this is very, very important. And I would like to tell you to all young breeders, pepper breeders, that now it is a trend that any hybrid, if it is in the market, we try to break it and develop the inbred lines. In that process, if the hybrid is developed through CMS system, you have to be very careful. You should never carry the sterile cytoplasm in that. In the long run, when you develop the inbred lines, that may cause some problem. So always you use it as a male parent or a pollen parent, and you can that pollen can be used. Otherwise, if you continuously go on selfing and selecting, your inbred lines will be carrying the sterile cytoplasm, which you have to be very careful. And in bell pepper, the RF gene is a very scarce. The CMS associated markers would facilitate the conversion of NMS, nuclear male sterility, the predominant system in bell pepper, to the CMS system. Predominantly, NMS is being used. These are the markers which are already available in the public domain for partial restoration, for mitochondrial gene, and for RF genes, which can be used in our routine breeding program. They are working well, and which can be used in maintaining our lines. These are the two RF genes which have been reported. Of course, the recessive gene, only absence of this RF only we are considering right now. This is present on chromosome 6. Recessive gene marker yet to be need to be identified. Coming to the podomular resistance, many resistance sources have been already published. People are using now mostly podomular resistance. It is available in majority of the lines. Even we at IHR, we could transfer this podomular resistance from buccatum through bridge crossing through Chinese to anum, and now we could release some varieties and also male sterile lines which are having resistance to podomular. The genetics also has been studied. This is the dominant and polygenic trait, the resistance source what we are having. And there are also reports in frutescens, it is incompletely dominant gene. And Joy et al. In 2017, they have reported a major single dominant gene for podomular resistance. And a podomular, they have also mapped the gene, that is PMR1. It is located on the chromosome 4. And this through GBS system, which we may have to validate the this marker with our male sterile lines, what we are using right now. Next, very important fungal pathogen is Phytophthora root rot. Your screening technique is very easy, very easily. With this, you can see the susceptible one and the resistant lines here. But being a polygenic trait, having QTLs markers linked to major QTLs at least, and will be very much useful for us to breed for resistance. The QTL mapping approach has been widely implemented to identify genomic regions affecting variations for different traits for marker-assisted selection. And meta-analysis also identified 30 meta-QTL regions distributed across 12 chromosomes in capsicum. That meta-QTL 5.1 and 5.2 related to Phytophthora capsici, fruit and root rot resistance were delimited. What is that sound coming, Arpita? Hello.
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you. Yes, what very much.
What is the background sound is coming? Is it from my side or?
No, it's Mr. Dhananjay. I request everybody to mute yourself, please. Please, ma'am, go ahead.
Phytophthora capsici, fruit and root rot resistance were delimited less than 1 centimorgan. Confidence intervals on chromosome 5. The candidate gene analysis of P5 meta-QTL revealed the functions related to histone methylation and demethylation, indicating the potential role of epigenetics for Phytophthora capsici resistance. Yeah, next coming to anthracnose fruit rot resistance. As we all know, earlier it Colletotrichum capsici and Colletotrichum gliosporiidis were the major species prevalent in our country. Now the capsici is termed as truncatum. These two causes pre and post harvest. Mainly in India, we observed only post harvest fruit rot. That is only at red ripe stage fruits getting infected. Later on, during our GTZ AVADC project, which has run for 6.5 years, that time at AVADC, they were telling acutatum was very serious, but at those days, acutatum was not really existing in our country. The sources what they identified using PBC 932, it was showing highly susceptible against our capsici and gliosporiidis species, which are prevalent in our country. But later on, this capsicum being a most susceptible, anum being very susceptible, the resistance is so far identified mainly in buccatum source is only showing good resistance against our species. Of course, the Chinese 92 is not, PBC 932 was not at all having, showing any resistance against the species prevalent in our country. Then they proposed a triple bridge cross method. Of course, as it is not cross compatible, using the bridge species like Chinese, they could successfully introgress the resistant genes by Yun and Park through conventional way. And the QTLs have also been identified using two populations of capsicum annuum with Chinese and PBC 80 into annuum, along with the flanking SNP based markers. Genetic inheritance studies revealed that monogenic recessive nature and duplicate gene action and polygenic and quantitative trait loci. Of course, this again depends upon the resistant source what we are using and also the pathogen, the isolate what we are using. And the embryo rescue coupled with there's some scar marker work has been done with PVC 80 introgressed with by Suor et al. In 2017. There are many markers have been reported publicly in public domain which are available. The characterization May et al. In 2017, they published that characterization pathogenicity of new record of anthracnose. Mainly in Korea, this has been published on various chili varieties causing Colletotrichum scovilli. This is another new species. They have molecularly and morphologically characterized and they have published. And this again belongs to the acutatum gland. This year, you all might have observed that all majority of the seed company germplasm, I visited one or two companies, completely they got affected because of unexpected rains. All green fruits got completely infected. I have a doubt, very strong doubt, that maybe this particular species, which is prevalent. Now those samples we have collected and given to our pathologist, he is working on it. Now this again belongs to the clade of acutatum. This group in Korea, the 35 isolates they have characterized according to morphological characteristics and nucleotide sequence data of internal ITS region and glyceraldehyde phosphodehydrogenase and beta turbulin. All the three regions they have done nucleotide sequence data, and the combined data set shows that all of these 35 isolates identified as this new species and morphological characteristics were directly correlated with the nucleotide sequence data. Notably, these isolates were recorded for the first time as the cause of anthracnose. This has been reported in 2017, but in our country recently we are getting for the past 2 years, we are getting this, probably this species, which we have to study further. And 40 cultivars they have actually screened and none of them are showing resistance. So we have to be very careful with this species. It's a very virulent species. At the green fruit stage itself, it's getting affected. Our Capsicum gliospora is also equally virulent, but they get expressed only at the red ripe stage. So they have done anthracnose disease caused by scovilli. They have done morphology characteristics also. The symptoms are very typically, here you can see this belongs to the truncatum. Our capsicum is entirely different group, and you can see the scovilli, it is almost all in acutatum gland. It is belongs to probably, we might have got this typical symptoms we could, everybody would have observed in their fields. This is becoming very serious nowadays. This is a widespread again in China, and it is also present in China. Now I think it has come to our country, and this resequencing of Capsicum chinensis of 932 and Capsicum annuum allele specific PCR markers and insertion deletion markers linked to green fruit test developed. This is located on chromosome 5. This is a very recent publication. They told they identified a marker which is present on chromosome 5. Yeah, bacterial resistance, as I told earlier, though chili as such will not wilt because of only due to bacterial wilt, except in the coastal areas. We have to be very careful with bacterial wilt resistant gene also. There are two papers where they have already identified markers on the AFLP, another one SSR marker, which may be used in our breeding work. And of course, nematodes, we have very good markers in the public domain, which are some markers are really working very well, and this is also available in the public domain, which will be of great use for the breeders to incorporate nematode resistance. Phytophthora rootrot, as I told, it's QTLs have been identified mainly on chromosome 5 and one metaQTL 5.2. It is located on chromosome 9. Even at our institute, we have also developed markers. Some of that slide, I don't know where it is. We also developed markers, and they're working very well. And using that, now we also developed two hybrids which are performing very good. And this year or next year, we'll be releasing those hybrids which are having good resistance to Phytophthora root rot. Next, coming to the cucumber mosaic viruses, cucumber mosaic virus, it's a very important virus. This is also very serious, and it is the AP transmitted virus. It's a single stranded RNA virus, and it's transmitted by aphids, non-persistent way, and it's a very common species to infect peppers. The damage caused by CMV depends mainly on the stage of plant infection. Any virus, the stage of plant infection is very important. If it gets infected at the early stage, by nursery stage, you will get zero yield. If it's get the infection gets delayed, at least we can harvest some fruits, some yield. Some early varieties also can, if it gets infected a little late, it won't affect much on the yield. So it depends upon the stage of infection. Many resistant sources have been identified, and a mode of inheritance also has been studied. And QTLs have been worked out, and two major QTLs have been reported by different groups of scientists. And recently, PVC 688, two QTLs, that is CMR 2.1 located on chromosome 2 and CMR 11, which is located on chromosome 11, were identified as key QTLs for resistance to CMV. The QTL region could be possible candidate gene for CMR 2.1. This is reported in the year 2017. Then very important diseases, potivirus, so that is chili venal motile virus. In India, we do not have PVY, but chili venal motile virus is a very serious important potivirus, which is affecting our crops in India. This CVMB and CMB both will co-occur, they will occur together also, because both are transmitted by aphids. Majority of the samples what our collaborators have tested, there are co-occurrence of both the viruses is common. Just looking at the symptom, we cannot make out what is this virus. We may have to test it and see. And there are seven genes already been identified, resistant genes, PVR1 to PVR7. Markers linked to these genes are also available. They're existing in the public domain. The references I have given here, chili venal motile virus, when we inoculate at the laboratory level, different varieties will show different types of, lines will show different types of symptoms. It varies with the genotype again. CVMA resistance, we do have in our Indian germplasm, it is not an issue. We also developed a marker, a bunch of markers associated with resistance. We are validating it. Our marker there, it is located in chromosome 9, which we are validating. Next, very important disease is chili leaf curl disease. Chili leaf curl, as you all know, it is not caused by one virus. There are many Gemini viruses. In that, mainly two chili viruses and two tomato viruses are very much there, where when we collected a lot of samples across the country and we checked, chili leaf curl virus is the major one of chili, and chili leaf curl Ahmedabad virus. These are the two chili leaf curl viruses, and tomato leaf curl Jaipur and New Delhi. These two viruses are also infecting chili. So this is again a single-stranded DNA virus and double-stranded, and has emerged as one of the most serious production constraint. The tendency of genetic recombination and acquisition of extra DNA components and a synergistic effect interaction among the different begomoviruses has resulted in rapid emergence of new viruses that can infect new host, causing new disease symptoms and to overcome new host resistance. Sources of resistance to Begamo pepper have been identified among the Chinese accessions in Mexico and in Bujoloke in India. Of course, when we used chili leaf curl, the Bujoloke is not maybe our, the accessions what we are maintaining, they are not resistant. And the capsicum annuum accessions, different accessions have been published by Sri Vachabandha. Many group of scientists have published this. Then inheritance of resistance was also worked out by some group of scientists. There are two primers very recently, Punjab Agriculture University, they have identified a marker which is linked, which is located on chromosome 6. But Punjab Agriculture University, they are working for tomato leaf curl Jaidepur virus. Their source, the resistant source developed is against Jaidepur virus. And this marker, when we used for our resistance material, it is not working. Of course, this will be very much useful for us to pyramid the genes. So this is the one new, recent paper. And then coming to the breeding for Tospoviruses, Tospovirus resistance is a single-stranded RNA transmitted by thrips in a persistent manner. It is found available, it is resistant sources are already available, different type mechanisms of resistance, hypersensitive reaction, and contains the dominant resistant gene TSW. TSW, it is in peppers, which has been, sweet peppers, which has been reported elsewhere, but this gene is not working for our virus, what is existing, that is grown at bud necrosis virus in India. And other Chinese resistant sources of hypersensitive reaction have been published by Jan and other scientists in 2000 and 2003. And Chinese has been reported to have monogenic dominant gene and non-allelic gene action has been reported in 2013. And the Bacatum accession PAM26-1 has been identified as resistant source against wild and resistant breaking aggressive isolate TSWV. This majority of the work has been done on TSWV in other countries, but the virus existing in India is different. Out of 102 genotypes, this work we have done at IHR, this is one of our students. We could identify some good sources of resistance. And this is the symptom expression on different accessions. It is mentioned here. So resistance sources are available, which need to be further. We have to have developed markers linked to that, and we have to, which can be useful and transferred into other backgrounds. Yes, breeding for thrips resistance. Thrips is becoming really very serious nowadays. Actually, breeding for insects, it is not as easy as as we do for diseases. This highly resistant against, there are different mechanisms, like morphological, or whether it is having any biochemical aspects, all different aspects we have to look into for thrips resistance. It should be an integrated way. Whereas for white fly, when we were screening for white fly resistance, when we were doing for LCV also, the lines which are having these trichomes, non-glandular trichomes, they are highly dangerous than a line which is not having trichomes at all. If it is a non-glandular trichomes, the white flies are happily sitting inside the those on the leaves and laying eggs, and they're highly susceptible to leaf curl virus actually. So again, the glandular, non-glandular trichomes, which we have to be very important when we are looking for morphological way of resistance for even thrips or white flies, any sucking pest in that matter. And this is the capsicum. There are some literature showing resistance to thrips. And the first QTL for resistance to thrips, actually the good work has been done in Netherlands on thrips resistance. That paper will be of very great use for breeders, for pepper breeders.
Excuse me, madam.
Species, yeah.
I have a question, madam.
Can you ask in the last?
Yes, madam, yes.
The thrips species, actually Scriptothrips lacerans, this is the chili thrips what we are finding actually. But in the recently we found this is everywhere now. This is a different species. It is Southeast Asian species. we collected a lot of samples and it has been morphologically identified as parvispinus. You can see the number of thrips and the extent of damage, the larva, the scraping entire epidermis, and very extensively it is getting infected. Farmers are spraying every day, almost every alternate day, and probably because of faulty agriculture practices and wrong chemical spraying and the wrong method of spraying, also very important. They're all below the leaf and the chemical what they're spraying is not reaching the insect. And also the life cycle. The life cycle, the pupa and the pre-pupa stage will be underneath the soil. Whatever the chemical they spray, these insects may get killed. But again, from here again, the adults are rising up. So probably that is also weather climate condition also very congenial. And because of the weather, its life cycle also got reduced probably. That may be the reason it has become very serious and farmers have really got frustrated.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes.
I think somebody else tried to share their screen and somehow your screen get disappear. So could you please share your screen again?
Oh.
No, madam, it's visible.
Is it?
Is it visible?
No, it's not visible, ma'am. Not visible. No, not visible.
We need to pin it.
In between, someone's tried to share screen. That's how.
Do you want me to reload again?
Please, ma'am, do so.
Please. Yeah.
How many slides you might have got missed?
No, only just this one. Just now.
Okay. What happened? My screen is.
It's coming, Dr. Madhavi.
Is it, sir?
It is coming.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, it is fine.
Okay. Okay, for my insisting here upon is for any breeder, we should understand the disease or the pest for what we are breeding and its life cycle. That's why I'm just insisting it has become really very serious, which we are, all of us have to look into. And these are 2 to 3 days time. They have this Netherlands group, you know, they are screening for thrips resistance, they have already, which has been done for a PhD work and damage caused by thrips, different methods they have shown, the leaf curling and deformation of the leaf and silvering damage caused by the thrips feeding and black spots caused by fecal material and silver damage caused by thrips feeding and black spots caused by the material and D is the detached leaf test method. This is the method they used for screening for thrips resistance, that group. And the nature of thrips resistance factors in the leaves, antibiasis as resistance mechanism. And of course they did QTL mapping and the plant traits associated with resistance such as trichomes, wax layer, color, toughness and thick cuticles have been presented by different group of scientists and markers also have been identified and they have published. This is all for Frankinella occidentalis. This is not for our thrips species. This is the QTL for resistance for this particular species of white clay and for leaf trichome density. Markers have been published and predicted genes in fine mapped QTL region. Sorry. This is also published for the Frankinella occidentalis and QTL chromosome 6 region. The host plant resistance in the thrips, actually, the thrips, as I told, there are 4 mechanisms which we may have to look into. One is the physical barriers, okay, the cuticle thickness or the pubescence, trichomes and all. Another one is a volatile. Volatiles, leaf pubescence and trichomes, and secondary defensive plant metabolites are indirect defense, such as emission of volatile organic compounds upon thrips feeding. And the damage typically appears as a silver scars, whereas Taspa viruses depicted the red virus particles vectored by thrips led to chlorotic ring spots. But this this is not this particular species is as on today it is not a vector for any virus which has to be studied further. You need not worry about the virus as such. The this particular new species is causing damage as a insect pest only, not as a vector. And the thrips attack activates a local plant immune system. The salicylic acid and jasmonic acids, this will have some effect. This is what this group have published very recently in 2021, very recent paper. These pathways are capable of manipulating host defenses through salicylic and jasmonic acid antagonism to benefit their vector. This is the plant host resistance which has been published by Sane and Kirsten in 2021, very recent paper. And here they have given how the plant can become tolerant to the thrips through different mechanisms. Modulation of plant inducible defenses, biotic elicitors, mainly the soil microorganisms and plant microorganisms, and also endophytes. These also have a great role, as well as abiotic elicitors such as UV light and photosynthetically active radiation and carbon dioxide can exploit a strategy to induce the resistance to the thrips. As I told earlier, the resistance breeding only will not work. We have to look into different aspects also. What I feel also with in my recent visit to Guntur, majority of the farmers are neglecting the soil health because they are taking the land on lease to cultivate chili. So they don't want to apply any FIM. They want to spray whatever you want. They want to spray everything on the plant only. But plant immune system is not able to withstand the thrips infection, the newly new insect. And the every day they are spraying, it is not responding at all. Probably the plant inherent resistance has lost, what I feel. So these are all we have to look into as a in total, we have to look into a plant system. Then only we can make plant more resistant. Only resistance will not help. That's what I would like to stress upon here. Then next we go for bioactive compounds in capsicum. Here the valerizins, as you all know, and capsaicinoids and carotenoids. Now capsaicinoids analogs are capsinoids, because in Western people, they cannot eat the pungent ones. Now the capsinoids are becoming very popular. This will have all the health benefits of capsaicin, but it will not be pungent. So these are, this is the capsaicinoids or capsinoids and carotenoids. They're having a lot of industrial use, mainly the geoxanthin. I heard that it is being used for in eye drops and all, and a lot of pharmaceutical use also it is there. The biological activity of capsicum biocompounds is already known. This is having a lot of biological activities, and health benefits also have been in Ayurveda itself. They were using the chili as the small chili peppers as a tablets actually. Now it has been proved. Scientifically, it has been proved, and it is being used as an anti-cancerous compound, which is having against different cancers. So this is being used, and the health benefits are being proved scientifically. For breeding for industrial purposes, apart from capsaicinoids, oleoresin color, pericarp thickness is also very much important, and dry matter. After you dry, what is the recovery? That is also important, and dry weight and yield. And these are the main targets for pepper breeding for industrial purposes or for good quality. And capsaicinoids, as you know, there are different fractions of capsaicinoids, capsaicin, dihydro, non-dihydrocapsaicin. These are the three major fractions which we have to look into. In this, non-dihydrocapsaicin has a major role. This will retain for longer period. So when we breed for high pungency, we have to look into this non-dihydrocapsaicin. As you all know, this is the capsaicin is located on the placenta of the fruit. Here you can see the blisters. And the capsinoids is a low pungent capsaicinoid analog, which was first isolated from a low pungent cultivar, CH19. It's a sweet one. They are similar structure of capsaicinoid, but have an yeast group instead of amide group. The major capsaicinoid nature, again, this also have different fractions, capsiate, dihydrocapsiate, not dihydrocapsiate. This is published in the year 2008. Coming to the color, the carotenoid pigments are responsible for various colors in hot and bell peppers are synthesized in the thalamines of a chromoplast during the ripening stage. Approximately 30 pigments have been recognized in the surface of the pepper fruits. Among them, these are the major carotenoids. That the very important one is the capsanthin, the major carotenoid of red peppers, and it contributes 60% of the total carotenoids, and it has also inhibitory effect on carcinogenic compounds. And oleoresin, as you know, this is oil which is being exported as such. The oleoresin is a liquid extract of oil acquired from green unripe ripening red and even dried fruit of capsicum. Oleoresin is a complex mixture of waxes, essential oils, numerous carotenoids, and pungent compounds, everything together. This oil is extracted and exported, and there, depending upon the pharmaceutical use, they will extract the compounds and use in their industry for their industrial purposes. Oleoresin have been used in the law enforcement department for temporary law enforcement. Of course, how it is, the uses they are telling, the pepper sprays, which is being used even for defense, by ladies for their self-protection. And commercialized products containing oleoresin have been licensed to use on bears and for self-defense purpose by the public also. The paprika, you all know, it's nothing but chili having zero pungency with very good color. This is paprika. Paprika oil is also having very good industrial use. The main uses of our bioactive compounds of capsicum species is food industry, very important, then pharmaceutical industry and cosmetic industry, and natural colors, even the beauty products they are using as a natural color, and pesticide industry also they are using. This capsaicin is having an effect. It is an animal repellent, and also against insects, a lot of work is being done. It's also being used in pesticide industry. As I told, for sale defense by army as well as by ladies, it is being used. A lot of genetic resources for high capsaicinoid compounds has been already reported. The people are also reported for different fractions of capsaicin also, capsaicin dihydro, non-dihydrocapsaicin. It has been reported. Genetic resources are available. It is not a problem. In Bujolokia, our line in 2017, it entered into Guinness Book of World Record. Later, many other accessions have been identified and reported. Now people are breeding for high pungency. You may be knowing the hottest peppers in the world. And coming to genetic resources for capsinoids, so these are the genetic resources for capsinoids, which have been published by various groups. These are the lines which is available in Anum, Frutisense, and China. Even Chinans also it is available. And the genetic resources for carotenoids have been, of course, as you know, the color is measured in ASTA values. This has been published by many people, and the sources are available. Even our land races like our Warangal Chappatta and our Kashmiri chili and our Badiki chili, the tomato chili, these are also all having more color value, more than 150 to 200 SHU, ASTA value. This got a GI tag, our Badiki chili. And genetic resources for high oleoresin content, more than 16%, 20 to 38%. There are different percentages of oleoresin content. Resources are available. And coming to the genetics of pungency, initially it was published as single dominant, but of course it is not. It is a quantitatively inherited trait, highly influenced by the environment. So their mode of inheritance has been given. The color is controlled by two loci. There are some publications it is controlled by three genes also. Red color and yellow color, the Y loci, and capsaicin synthetase gene. This is the main gene which is conferring color, dark red color. And the markers associated with pungency and capsaicinoids, it is already in the public domain, which are linked to different genes, PUN genes, and there are five QTLs. So by Guha studies, following GPS, they have identified five QTLs located on chromosome 2, 3, 4, and 10 associated with capsaicinoid content over multiple locations over 2 years in two real populations it has been studied. And five genes have been already were identified as candidates controlling capsaicinoid content. Yang et al. In 2016, they also identified five genes, group of genes, which have been conferring for capsaicinoids. This is from Fortisense. And the Capsicum genome database with annotated genes available in the database of Sol Genomics, which for further exploitation of identified genes, functional markers, and development through candidate gene association mapping method. There are different candidate genes identified for keratinoid biosynthesis for color. It is also available in the public domain. Many people have published. In our lab, we have worked on one single nucleotide change. We found red color to yellow color, one single nucleotide. And that we identified as an amino acid substitution also. And then introgression of pungency genes, we are also doing at IHR. Some markers also we have identified between non-pungent, pungent. Again, in the pungent, different levels of pungency also, we could identify some marker. Of course, further studies was required. We are doing it. We are at it. Apart from that, abiotic stress, salt tolerance, maybe at seed germination, sodium chloride, and drought tolerance at seed PEG, we can use PEG 6000. At germination stage itself, we can screen for salt and drought tolerance. Like then, the data we can take on at different concentrations of PEG and sodium chloride, what will be the vigor of the seedling, how it is growing. Based on that, we can have some idea of its tolerance against the salt and this thing. And for heat tolerance also, good work has been done. And there are tolerant genotypes, Punjab, Guchadar, Ajit 1, based on the TIR method. Okay, this is also from our lab. And, Dr. Smarnika Mishra, she has published through TIR studies some heat tolerant genotypes she could identify. And for drought tolerance, growing inside the cover and looking at the root mass at different levels of moisture, application of water, we could study some physiological traits. For accelerated breeding, precise and faster phenotyping is very much important, as I have shown you, and the fast forwarding of the generations and the fast marker development and multi-location yield trail selection of lines and hybrid development. These are the major criteria which we have to look into, and a genome-wide SNP discovery and population structure analysis in PEPPER using GBS. This work has been published by this group of people. The assessment of level of genetic diversity of subsets of 222 cultivated PEPPER genotypes, and a GP analysis generated a total of this many master tags, of which 43.4% are uniquely aligned to CM334. Now see, the CM334 complete genome data is available online. So when they compared, they got this much percentage of unique alignment, and the genotypes are grouped not only based on the geographical origin, but also on the fruit-related features. And the SNP marker development they have done and estimated the genetic diversity of 191 Capsicum annuum accessions. And the genotyping by sequencing data has proved useful and reliable for the identification of high-quality SNPs exploited for investigating genetic diversity and defining the population structure of Capsicum annuum collections. And this is a very good piece of work. And phenotyping should be very breeder friendly. That is another very crucial thing. If anything, we want to screen for any pathogen. Actually, correct season, correct temperature, and everything should be there for any pathogen to express for screening. For that, recently Neeraj Singh et al. In 2020, they have published a very good paper on what are the different methods, phenotypic easy methods. Of course, this is in tomato for bacterial wilt. They have published easier method at the laboratory conditions, the faster screening protocol they have published, and in the small tray, vials keeping inside the lab, how fast we can screen. And for in vitro screening assays, we can also look into biotic abiotic stress growing inside the in the media creating, and we can select for the. And GWAS for thermotolerance in peppers has been published by Akira et al. In 2020. This is determining food set and pollen germination, and they have reported good yields at high temperature, and different lines they have used, and they have told that these are the lines which are of great use, and also the pollen germination rate is also very strongly associated to the SNPs of the same region located on chromosome 3 and 6. There are some good publications which you can look into. And of course, now we are looking at rootstock breeding, which is very important, especially for bell peppers, where we are cultivating the same area for polyhouse cultivation. Same soil we are using again. So in that cases, we have to have a rootstock which is having resistance to major soil-borne diseases, at least Phytophthora, bacterial wilt, and nematodes. These are the major biotic stresses inside the polyhouses we find. And of course, the Solanum wild species, the thorium being used, but as you all know, the growth of thorium is very slow. So now we are using chili as a rootstock, incorporating all the three diseases into chili rootstock that can be used as a rootstock for the bell pepper. On this line also we are working now. We could identify and we could develop some good lines, rootstock breeding for multiple soil-borne pathogens. Of course, now the double haploid populations, this is also very important, has in our breeding work. Many of the company people are already using it, which is of great use for us, and we can reduce the number of generations to forward. And then there are some good publication here on double haploid production in peppers. Yeah, this paper has come very recently on vitamin variation in capsicum species, which we always neglected. We never thought about its nutritive value, provide opportunities to improve nutritive value to human diets. This group has 101 pepper lines they have screened, and they could see a lot of variation for the pungency, for vitamin A, vitamin C. They could find a lot of variation, which can be really exploited in our breeding programs. And of course, breeding for mechanical harvesting is also very important. A lot of funding is being given for mechanical harvesting research, where we have to look into plant architecture, fruit attributes, whether it is attached strongly, whether destocking type is there for easier harvesting. Of course, we have to be very careful. Again, as soon as ripened fruit should not fall. And that also we have to keep in mind. These are the different traits which we have to look into for mechanical harvesting. And recently from our Devi Hosur Center, and they have identified two lines, the Siddha 1 and Siddha 2, the destocking types. This is one. And a metacutial analysis, a set of quantitative loci which have been detected and positioned onto the genetic linkage map exactly. The metacutial analysis for different traits of capsicum remains lacking. And it would be necessary to reevaluate identified QTLs for more precise mass and for genetic improvement. This is very important. The Dennis group, they have recently published the metacutial analysis. This has been done for Phytophthora rotortensis gene already, which I explained earlier. And they have identified for diverse traits, the metacutials were identified. And as I told you, the pepper the genome database is already available for pepper genotype CM334. And which is available on the Sol Genomics Network, which will be of great use for the pepper breeders. And of course, the speed breeding. This is also a very important one, which we may have to look into. There is one publication of ornamental peppers. Through conventional pepper, where it will take 215 days, through this method, in 153 days, their breeding cycle can be reduced. And spree breeding is also initiated they also got in West Virginia State University, they got very good funding, and they are working on this for peppers. So the approach is to accelerate the breeding programs is in vitro strain germplasm for biotic and abiotic stresses and double haploid generation. It's very important to as in our work and faster marker development using NGS and their use in marker assisted selection so that we can develop the achieve our goals little faster. These are some of the approaches. Thank you so much. I think.
Thank you very much, Dr. Madhavi. It was an excellent presentation. You covered almost every aspect which people might have interest in.
And sir, I might not have covered very intensively, but there is
shortage.
Having spent 30 years in the crop, I know it's a challenge for you to select what to present, what not to. And I definitely, it's a very good presentation. I am sure there are 144 participants who have benefited from this. I also see in the group presence of Dr. Deshpande, who has also worked a long time in Chili's. And I also see Dr. Khadi, who also initially had some work in Chili's, though he's a cotton expert. So now I'm sure all these people who have been listening to your excellent talk will have several questions.
I hope if I can answer little of your questions, yeah. I'll be very grateful.
I'm coming to that. I know we have time till 12:30. Dr. Aparna tells me the session has to go on till 12:30. So I would request people to ask some quick questions and also put all your questions in the chat box, which will forward to Dr. Madhavi, and she will respond to your questions. So please, now it's open for questions. Dr. Aparna?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Madhavi ma'am, for such an extensive presentation. And I'm sure a lot of people must have questions to be, you know, to discuss with you. So here is Kharakwal, sir. You're raising the hand. Please ask the question.
Well, it's not a question. I would like to congratulate Dr. Madhavi for an excellent presentation. And she had presented everything about chickpea, everything under the sun, rather. But I somehow missed one aspect. It's more than 45 years that we had a mutant variety of chili in India. The variety of last release was MDU1 in 1976. So I was wondering whether something has been done on mutation breeding of chilies. And in fact, recently I had contacted her specifically for this, and she had already informed me that not much is being done on that. But I wonder actually that why perhaps this has not been taken up later on or recently, because nowadays a lot of molecular breeding, say, technologies are available to enhance the efficiency of mutations. So I wonder that what is her take on that? It's not a question, it's only a query. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Mutation breeding, of course, in my opinion, I am not against mutation breeding. It is hitting in the dark, sir. We already having resistant sources, well-defined resistant sources, which we are using in our program. Mutation breeding, where we have to go, means when we do not have the variability, required variability, then now again the new technique, molecular biology techniques are coming in. I don't know, I may be wrong, but I am not for mutation breeding, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Kindly pardon me.
Nothing to pardon that. It's not my, say, property, you know.
Dr. Kharakwal, as we all know, he has been a pioneer in mutation breeding and has it to his credit several very prominent varieties. So obviously his obsession is for mutation breeding. That's the reason he asked that question. It's so okay. Personal opinion. Okay.
Yes.
Next question, please.
Yes, madam.
Yes, please.
You mentioned that there are two LCV markers are available. So one is developed by PAU, which is working against only this Joydevpur virus. And there is one more marker, madam, CA516044. How about that marker, madam? Whether it will work against only specific virus strain or it will work against all strains, madam?
All strains, it is quite impossible. This year, we are developing markers using biparental population. Okay, it may work, it may not work unless we test it and see. We cannot. I tested only the PAU marker, which is not a user being worked for my resistance uses.
Okay. The second question is, madam, how about using this tomato LCV markers in chili, madam?
I have already used. They are not working. Already we have done it.
Okay. Then the third question, madam, this Thrips parvispinus, madam, which is causing huge havoc in Guntur, of course, in Andhra and Telangana, madam.
Yes.
So this particular thrips was noticed in January, madam, if I am correct.
January. You are correct.
Yes, madam. But January didn't cause much problem, madam. All of a sudden, now this season, it has become a big issue, madam.
Last year, we found it at the harvesting stage. By then, our crop already yield set, everything, it has overcome all that. So this year, it started from the beginning. There, because of heavy rains, the planting got delayed. The people, some people have planted early, some people have planted late. The plants which are already existing in the field, already having the incidence, that thrips already gone to the newly planted ones. So this time, maybe because of the weather change, it started from the beginning. That is why it has caused a great havoc. Last time, we have seen only in the end of the crop, not in the beginning.
So what factors could have led to this all of sudden emergence of this particular pest, madam, in your opinion, madam?
Mainly weather, climate. Second one, we have our faulty agriculture practices. We have to accept it. Mainly these are the two what I feel. We are neglecting soil health completely, which we have to look into.
And the last question from my side is, madam, is there only this parvispinus is existing, or are there any other species are also there, madam?
Actually, along with us, Dr. Rachana from NBR also visited all the plots where we have gone. She collected all the samples and we got the report. Majority is the same species. One or two other minor species are there which we need not worry upon. Main species is this only. They are already identified.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you.
Dr. Jagar, you raised the hand. You like to ask the question?
Yes.
Rajiv?
Ma'am, I look forward to thank you very much for such a brilliant and polished talk. My question is regarding, these days the buzzword is about white crosses and incorporating, like you also indicated, the distant genotypes of the wild germplasm. However, although in theory we say that, the markers are, the maps are now saturated and we have GBS and we have, let's say the micro arrays, the SNP arrays, at least in India and probably abroad also, forward selection for the markers, MAS, is the vogue. Everybody wants to do it. But when we are talking about backward selection, the background selection, and when we are talking about introgressing the wild germplasm, we are actually talking about, because then there are in fact more complicated issues like removing the linkage drag also. So that sort of a work is still, I think it's in infancy, if not almost non-existent, at least in this part of the world. And, so we are talking about basically the SNP arrays and the GBS, that's where the marker intensive works come into play. Now, how do you think the molecular breeding could actually play a really a good, a determining role as far as incorporation of this field into the white process is concerned?
Yeah, as you told rightly, background selection is also equally important. Mainly any resistant wild species we are using, normally we use it as a pollen parent. Right. To avoid at least the cytoplasm site, at least we can avoid that drag genomic thing. And further we'll be selecting using the markers available. As a breeder, right now, probably I started my work as a conventional breeder. Now only I am at the pace of molecular biology. If any marker is available of the interest of my trait, that will be more than enough for me to develop a variety. Okay, marker assisted selection is very, very important because the prevalence of different isolates, different strains and all. Now the pyramid, the resistant genes, we also should have good microbiology information for the breeder, which will be of real great help to the breeder. I hope I addressed your question, Dr. Rajiv.
Thanks, ma'am. I mean, what you mean to say is, even if we use the foreground markers nicely, that should be a big help. Okay, ma'am.
Thank you.
Dr. Meghraj.
Yes, good afternoon, ma'am. I have a small question regarding anthracnose. You mentioned about Colletotrichum scovilli. And what is the difference between the scovilli and the gliosporates, ma'am? Does the gliosporates only affect in red ripe stage in Indian condition?
Not exactly like that. The gliosporates and the truncatum, they get affected at green fruit stage, but they won't express. Once the fruit ripens, the expression will be there. Whereas these acutatum group, they are expressing at the green fruit stage itself. When I started my career, even Dr. Deshpande sir also is there in the group. He can also tell. He also did a lot of work on anthracnose. Initially, we never saw in the green fruit. The symptom we never observed. Though fungi may be there, we cannot rule out. But it won't express. The symptom expression will not be there. But now, even the green fruits are severely getting infected. So probably that acutatum clad of that new species I am worried about, I will be discussing with my fungal pathologist. Already he started working. We collected a lot of samples and given him. We have to look into it.
And ma'am, you specifically mentioned about a specific symptom of growing a small like smut-like symptom in scovilli, whitish this part.
That is published from China, that paper.
Okay. But in Indian condition, as we observed, it is very specific as a ring spots. We observe on same symptoms, but in green stage.
The Korean paper symptoms are exactly typically like ours. Yes, the Chinese paper, that white mass I could see.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Theo, would you like to make any comments or remark?
Lucy has raised hand. Lucy, sir.
Yeah, good morning, ma'am, and thank you for a very nice and informative presentation, and this session is really useful. Ma'am, my question is on the thrips, since it is evolving as a major concern in Telangana and AP, and also we observed in Maharashtra. So my question is, have we started any approach for thrips species molecular identification? So that, because as you mentioned, there is some problem with the management part also, how the farmer is managed. So have we made any efforts on molecular identification of the species?
Yes, Lucy. Not only Maharashtra, even Chhattisgarh, we are getting a lot of samples. Tamil Nadu, many of the states now we are getting actually. Molecular, no, just 2 weeks back, we had 2 to 3 weeks back, we got the samples. Morphological characterization is completed. Now we have to look into molecular characterization also. Not yet done.
Okay, ma'am.
Has to be taken up.
Yeah, that's, I think, a very good effort.
Yes.
And ma'am, for CMV, CMV is also evolving as a major threat in many locations and many parts of India. So have we started any molecular characterization of the aphid species also for CMV?
Of this virus you're asking about?
Yes, for aphids causing cucumber mosaic virus.
Virus, I think Dr. Reddy group might have done already.
Okay.
In tomato this year, last year, it was very serious in Maharashtra. Yeah. The Trilonga disease, something they were telling about. There was a large, huge, there was a lot of problem actually. That was also CMV. Plant will not have any symptom. Even in Chile, we are observing nowadays, only the fruits will show the symptoms.
Yes, ma'am, it is in tomato, it is on the fruits, but in Chile, we are finding moreover the symptoms are in the leaves, and there's a lot of variability in the symptoms.
Variability depends upon the cultivar actually. It varies with the cultivar. Molecular characterization, Dr. Reddy has done already. If you want, you can discuss with him. Okay.
And ma'am, my another question is, for speed breeding protocol, is any publication available from our National Institution for Speed Breeding Protocol in hot pepper?
No, not IHR, no. But in other countries, people are working. that I have just presented here from in India, not it.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Dr. Vindhyachal Gupta.
Yes.
So good afternoon, and thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
It was a really nice presentation. Just I have one question regarding that your four hybrids what you have developed, and that was mentioned while your introductory remark by the admin panel. So can you tell us that what kind of that specialty that hybrids have, and what kind of steps you have taken to come up with that such a product?
Dr. Gupta, I think this calls for a very elaborate discussion. You can talk with
you can mail me.
Okay, fine.
The quick question.
Thank you.
Yeah, because that will take a long time to explain all the four. Am I right, Madhavi?
Yes, sir. I have new five hybrids also. Everything I will.
You can explain them to you separately. You can please talk.
Just mail me.
Get in touch with them. Viga Sira. You have a question?
Yeah, ma'am, actually, due to some reason, I'm not able to listen all the presentation. So it is requested to you, if this lecture is recorded, I think it is recorded, to send the link of the recording lecture on the mail. So it will be very thankful for me.
Ms. Tiwari can help.
Mr. Ira, recording will be, posted on the ATPBR group. You can access from there.
Ma'am, where can I find the link?
On ATPBR group, you can see all the recorded videos are there. You can check it in 1 or 2 days. It will be there.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Dr. Deshpande, sir, is there on the group?
Dr. Deshpande. Dr. Arvind.
Listen from him.
So he left just after you finishing up your presentation.
Okay. So maybe we can take a last question for Mr. Jadhav. Ramkrishna Jadhav.
Jadhav has raised hand. Please unmute yourself and speak, Dr. Ramkrishna. He's muted. Please unmute yourself, Dr. Ramkrishna. Hello?
No. If not, then maybe Sharan sir, you can close the session.
Thank you very much, Madhavi. It was very interesting. You started with the teamwork importance, and you covered, as I said already, almost every important aspect. You touched upon those. And as I was listening to you, as I said, 30 years condensing into 1 hour is very tough. So we realized we should have made it into two phases. I think we will make it as a series of lectures, depending on the reaction from participants, and we will discuss this among ourselves and want to make it series, because there are many aspects. I'm sure now all the participants here got a glimpse of what all you have done and all excellent work you have done. I think we as ATPBR and also the group here on behalf of them, we would like to make good use of your expertise. Maybe we would like to arrange a series of lectures in future. Is that okay, Dr. Aparna? Can we think of that? Yeah.
That's a wonderful idea if ma'am is agree.
Madam, we'll make madam agree. Madam has to share her knowledge. We want her knowledge to be shared. So next webinar, I would like mention here, we are getting very good response from the participants, and we are getting very good attendance. As I said, this time, though on a Sunday morning, 140 people joined, and then I'm sure everybody has benefited from this very interesting talk. Next month's webinar is by Dr. Samir Sawant, who is a senior scientist at National Botanical Research Institute, NBRI, Lucknow. And he has done extensive work on genomics in cotton. And incidentally, we finished just one cotton breeding training program last week. It was excellent. It was very well attended. So in continuation of that, I'm sure Dr. Sawant will be mentioning about his experiences in genomics and cotton improvement and cotton breeding. We will announce this, the date of the webinar. So please do keep looking at the details, and please do participate. And those were the things which I wanted to say. Dr. Aparna, you want to say anything as a concluding
Yeah,
remark?
so yeah, just to before concluding, Dr. Ramakrishna is raising the hand again and again.
Yeah, Aparna.
Yeah, he's
yes,
there.
Yes,
he's there.
Sorry, sorry to disturb actually, this Sharan sir and Aparna.
Yeah.
Thank
Go
you,
ahead.
It's a very good session actually.
Thank you.
Very great opportunity to hear you. My question is, as a trips, many people, and you also visited the Andhra Telangana, it's a burning issue and it's a major problem. Maybe Chile area may drop in future also if this is a continuous serious problem. Are we planning any IPM project from IHR side for this like this issue? Adi Madam.
IPM, yes, we already planned actually, and also Telangana government also wanted to have one project like that, which we will be taking ahead. And in Orissa, we got funding already. We will be doing there also. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
I think Dr. Aparna, we can conclude. Once again,
yeah,
thank
it's
you.
Time very much to close the session. If anyone have any question, please drop the mail. We will try to reach ma'am to you know get the your answer as soon as possible. Thank you all for joining the session. Thank you, ma'am, for spending the time and for such a wonderful presentation today. Thank you, Sharan sir, for a great moderation. And thank you all the participants. And we are looking forward to see you again next month with another exciting lecture. Thank you all. Have a very good day.
Thank you.
Bye bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye bye. Good day.
Thank you all.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sharan.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.